Welcome to the Mad House. What is going on, ladies and gentlemen? Today we have another episode of Summer of Guests, and this is the one.
The one.
We've been waiting for a while to do something. I mean, this is just. I'm speechless right now. We are here with Mr. John Massari, from the composer from Killer Klowns from Outer Space. And how you doing, John?
I'm doing fine.
it's good to be here. We are excited to talk to you a little bit, open up your mind of behind the scenes of what it was like making the movie,
okay.
How you feel about it coming to the event this year at Halloween Horror Nights, mm-hmm. And just what you've been doing.
All right, just
in general. So we will, of course, just start off with how you been doing.
Doing really well. It's been very, very busy, especially the past 3 years. Especially with the Killer Klowns brand having a resurgence,
which
is really awesome. Because as you know, the Kyoto brothers and I and everyone that worked on the film, we put a lot of work into that film for what you see.
Yeah.
You know, and of course, in our minds, we saw it as something even bigger.
Yeah.
So, but people have grown a great affection for the movie over the years, and it's been a very generational thing. I mean, it's gotten to the point where like grandparents are showing it to their grandchildren.
Oh yeah,
you know,
yeah.
And little kids are discovering it. There's a kid named Els Knight in Manchester, England.
Definitely,
that he was so inspired by the movie and other movies like it to pursue stop motion animation.
Wow.
So he keeps in touch with myself and the Kyoto brothers and shows his latest filmmaking adventures and many others.
Yeah.
It's too numerous to mention. So it's kind of it's an interesting aspect. This movie is an interesting aspect of Americana film, cinematic film, especially in the horror genre, that kind of got, kind of just like, was a little dormant for a bit, and over the years has grown its audience. Actually, I don't think it's grown its audience. I think it's earned its audience.
I think you know, you're spot on that, because this is a movie that I saw for the first time when I was like 6 or 7 years old,
mm-hmm.
and I immediately fell in love with it. It was one of those points where I'd go to my cousin's house every time they had it on DVD, and I wanted to steal the DVD from them, because every time I went over, I was like, let's watch Killer Klowns.
Right.
And over the years, my just love for it grew and grew. Most recently, we bought the Fatso mask at Midsummer Scream from Trick or Treat Studios. They make great quality masks.
He looks like a giant wad of chewing gum.
So when I saw this at Midsummer Scream, I was like, this would be a perfect set piece for when we do, of course, the podcast. But this is also just a good collector's item to have, because I've always wanted to get my hands on a mask and stuff like that. Of course, the Blu-ray. When I got a good paying job, I was like, I have to have the Blu-ray in my collection, upgraded from the DVD,
mm-hmm.
and so now we're here, and this is it's grown its cult following, and we are definitely big fans of the film.
Mm-hmm.
And I have to say, I think what really makes this movie, obviously, is your music.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, I mean, the cinematography and the storytelling is phenomenal, but every great movie, mm-hmm. is not good without its music.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel with the way the style of this music was, it was kind of ahead of its time,
mm-hmm.
at the time being. And I really enjoy the sound of the movie, because not only do you have, like, of course, the iconic song from the Dickies,
mm-hmm.
which is one of my favorites.
Oh, this is awesome. Yeah.
Yeah. And that's one of my favorite songs. I'll blast that when I'm at work and stuff like that. And but you have, of course, your music that translates to each scene, setting a different tone to each one.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, you have that like circus style music mixed with like some electronic kind of like rock, from what,
mm-hmm.
I hear.
Mm-hmm.
And I really enjoy that. How was it like when you guys were preparing for the movie? How did you know what kind of sound you wanted for this?
Well, that's a very good question. It's a very interesting aspect of this of this aspect of filmmaking, which is coming up with a music score that fits a movie. That's that you basically create like a kind of like a musical language that everyone associates with the movie. So when I first saw the movie, the only thing it had on it was the theme song, which I thought was awesome. I go, oh great, someone did a theme song. That's very awesome. And but the rest of the movie had no music in it. And which is, by today's standards, is very odd, because some editors feel that they can't edit a movie, make the edits work, unless they have a music track to cut with, mm-hmm. right? And back then, the editor of this film, Christopher Roth, really great editor, still working today, he edited the movie to story, to time, to script, to make it just move. Even so, even without music, the movie moved along. Yeah, is all the cuts coincide with the story, which makes my job actually really easy, because it goes from where oftentimes I get a movie where it has temp track, and what's running through my mind is like, okay, I have to copy that sound. Okay, I have to like listen to. There's a whole degree of research that goes into like trying to emulate another sound instead of the emotion. Now, some people put something in. This is just like a placeholder. It gives you an idea. For instance, I just finished a Western, and the opening title had something from Aaron Copland. And he goes, "Well, I love Aaron Copland. I love this piece of music, but I don't have to have something that sounds exactly like it. I just need something pastoral, you know, because the movie starts with an aerial shot over, like, you know, Monument Valley, you know, really beautiful stuff. So, okay, I know what to do." And that movie, by the way, was not temp tracked. That was a movie directed by Josh Becker. He's part of, like, the Sam Raimi community of filmmakers in the Midwest. But back to Killer Klowns, it didn't have anything, and it was just fascinating to watch, because actually, it was without sound effects and without music, it was actually scarier looking. Oh, wow. Because especially the scene, it's so funny, the scene where, I forgot the name of the clown, I don't know if it's Slim, he just walks up and he appears at a bus stop and there's a bunch of people waiting.
Yes.
That was actually kind of terrifying looking. It's like, wow,
yes.
Who would want to see that?
Yes.
You know, that's like something's going down and it doesn't appear to be good, you know? And So after that particular screening, there was myself and maybe 25 or more composers, and we all got a VHS.
Yeah, old school.
Yeah, of the film, not a QuickTime, a VHS, and we went home and everyone went to their places and came up with some music, and I zeroed in on the scene in the spaceship. Because there were so many different moods, and it was a kind of like a chase scene, and it kind of got the movie going. You know, that was a scene that, like, okay, we're here in the second reel within the first 20 minutes. Actually, I believe it's in the first reel. Yeah, it's in the first reel. You're going to see the spaceship. Not only is the spaceship, you're going to be inside it.
Yeah.
And our two heroes are going to be exposed to just about everything that's going to come in the movie, and they have nothing but fear and question marks on their head. It was really well edited, designed, and put together, that scene. So I said, I'm going to do that and marching into the town, because that's gonna set the pace of the movie. That's gonna define the movie.
I have to say too, that march into the town is probably like one of my all time favorite scenes in that movie. You have, of course, you have the clowns who have just, you know, landed on our world,
right.
And it's terrifying with that song, because they're walking very slow. You see a Crescent Cove right there, mm-hmm. and then they're walking slowly into town. On top of that, you have the fog rolling in on them, mm-hmm. which makes it even more like a cinematic shot.
Right.
But with the music of the march coming in, it's terrifying, because like you're watching these clowns walk in and you're just like, okay, they're obviously up to no good. You know that,
right.
it's time to unleash the chaos.
It's actually more terrifying without the music, believe it.
Really?
Yeah, because it was like, it's silence, and creep, creep, creep. One of them looks back, and It's like, what's going on? This is like so, this is so not right, you know? Yeah. And, but I wanted it to be fun because one of the directions the Keeler Brothers had, we want to be scary. We don't want to be scary all the time. We want to be fun. We want to have humor, but we don't want to be silly with the music because basically if you had silly, goofy music throughout the, there would be no contrast.
Yeah.
So that's why there's like, you know, dead on classical movie music, and then every once in a while you go to something like a weird cross between, you know, it's like synth you know, synth metal of the day, and because at the time I was listening to the BC Boys.
Oh, nice.
And Van Halen had came out with an album that I had. I was listening to Frank Zappa, and I said I want to do something odd and bizarre. And oddly enough, that theme, that Killer Clown March, I had written when I was in high school.
Wow.
So I was in a band called Crisis, and we would play like Led Zeppelin, Kiss, my goodness, Blue Oyster Cult, and, you know, what we used to call back in those days, hard rock.
Oh, yeah.
Because the official term metal came out like around 1980, you know, just a little bit before 19...
Yeah, when like the thrashing hit and everything. Yeah.
So we just called it hard rock. So we decided we were going to do some original stuff. So I came up with that, and I would start playing it to them. And they go, okay, what chords are those? I go, well, it's not really chords. It's kind of a riff.
Yeah.
You know, and these are the notes. Yeah, but what? It's got to be a chord that we can play along with. I guess, well, if you put it together, it's kind of like a D major 7 chord. And they flipped out, and they go, that's a jazz chord. That's a jazz chord, John. Now, you have to understand, I played in a rock band, like a heavy rock band, right? Hard rock band. But I also played in the jazz band. I played in the symphonic band. You know, I used to listen to Black Sabbath, but I also used to listen to Isaac Hayes.
Yeah.
I don't know if you know who Isaac Hayes is. He did to Shaft.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, theme to Shaft. So this is Isaac Hayes. I also listened to Burt Bacharach.
Okay.
You know, I was also listening to musicals.
Yeah.
I was listening to classical music, all kinds of stuff. So they got all flipped out. They go, you know, don't try to like, you know, force us to play all that other crap you like, you know. So basically it just stayed dormant.
Yeah.
And when I saw Killer Klowns, I go, that piece of music, I didn't have a name for it. Its time has come. So it was just like, hey, that's the way things work. That's the way fate works, you know?
Definitely. I'm like yourself. I'd listen to everything under the sun. You can polka. You'll catch me listening to polka. You'll catch me listening to, you know, some great marches.
Right.
The Clown March, was there any marches that, you know, you wanted, like you based it off of or anything of that sort?
No, I just noticed that had to be... Well, that's a good question because I did use something later on that's along the lines of that concept you're talking about. But for the Killer Clown March, I just wanted something very definitive, very disjointed that, you know, oh, okay, people can hear the first four notes and know what it is. You know, it's like it's got its stamp on it. That's what I wanted. Like a sculpture will have like a stamp of their work. There's something... And you know, I've actually used it in a variety of different ways inside the movie.
Definitely, I did follow that theme throughout. Like when you can hear parts of it.
Well,
throughout.
When you see Mike jump on the hood of the car to see where he's going, that's actually where it first appears.
Okay,
you know, but it's like light, you know, and it's like expanded, and then we hear it officially. Oh, actually, you hear it in the chase too.
Yeah,
you know, it shows up in the chase in what we would call a variation.
Definitely.
But what you're talking about, a march, is like when the clowns are vacuuming up everyone.
Uh-huh.
That was like, that's like a different piece of music on its own. And I treated it like if it was, there were Nazi tanks rolling into Poland during World War II. Like from a documentary documenting that
event. Thank you, Alexa.
Thank you, Alexa. Hope she went. Okay, Alexa, play music by John Massari. It won't show. Let's see what she.
There we go.
Alexa, louder.
There's the, yeah, that's exactly what we're talking about right now, too. Right? So, you know, that's a, yeah.
Perfectly on cue.
Perfectly on cue.
This is the song we were talking about.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so coming up here. Dun, 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 dun. Okay, it's coming up. Oh, no, actually, it's not coming up. But here it is. That's a different variation of it also.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
Alexa, off. So.
That was awesome.
That was really cool.
I'll be watching a movie, and all of a sudden, out of nowhere, she'll say, I don't know that song. Like, someone in the movie had said something that sounded like Alexa, you know? So anyways, back to where we were. So that when they're vacuuming up all the, I wanted that to be serious too. And that part of the movie is in the seventh reel. And usually that's the toughest part of a movie because it's like your audience is either going to go, oh, is the movie over again? Or it's like, wow, what's happening next?
Yeah.
So we take a big turn there. There's a big part after that. They go into the spaceship and then the spaceship blows up and what have you. So, so as far as, you know, that Killer Klown March theme, I was able to get a lot of out of those notes. I mean, it all goes back to my classical training is like, you know, let's say like Beethoven's Symphony Number 5. It's just four notes. Da 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 da. That's it.
Yeah.
And 40 minutes later, he's got all this music based off of variation, bouncing off of that. You know, so it's basically, you know, just good old tried, true, tested theme and development, you know.
Definitely. So Killer Klowns just actually turned 30 recently.
Yes.
I mean, like
officially it's 31.
31 now. Yeah, right. But it's been, I can't believe it's been, I've only been alive for 21 of those years. it's been 31 years though. Mm-hmm. And that's an iconic milestone for this film.
Right.
I mean, this film to this day in the 80s still lives up to its reputation. Mm-hmm. I still think, in my opinion, the makeup still lives up to today. Mm-hmm. I love the way the clowns look. They're terrifying. And of course, your music is one of the most iconic scores probably for me in horror movie history and stuff like that. I love your score. What's the journey been like for that 30 years, man? I mean, it's been, you have live shows and everything.
Well, yeah, it's let me just say, give props to the Kyoto Brothers.
Oh yeah.
Because the Kyoto Brothers are truly artists. Charlie and Steve and Edward, they all have very, very good, very, very keen eyes for creative visuals, and each one of the clowns is very personalized.
Yeah,
you know, they spend a lot of time. To this day, I'll hang out with Charlie, and he'll just pull out a piece of paper. He can't stop drawing. He's always drawing something, and you know, they're very diverse. They don't just draw clowns. There's all sorts of things. I've seen Steve Kyoto. Kind of mentor artist, and they bring him a bunch of clown stuff, and he goes, "Did you ever think of, you know, you told me you live on a farm with horses? Yeah, did you ever draw horses? Well, all the, you know, different the musculature of the horse and what have you. It's fascinating. And he teaches at Art Center.
Really?
Yeah. Okay. Steve Kiero does. Awesome. So and I sort of teach. Well, I mentor.
Okay.
Composers.
Okay.
I don't like charge them money and stuff like that. I just listen to their music and I make suggestions and you know, if someone comes to me, they have to be at a certain level that we can say, okay, let's refine what you're doing.
Definitely.
You know? So like I'm not going to sit in front of class and play some, okay, what kind of chord is that? I mean, that's very important, but yeah. I'm just not, that's not where I excel.
Definitely.
So, but what's the journey been like? Well, here's the really, heartwarming and gratifying aspect of all this is that I have inherited like an extended family. Like,
yeah.
I feel like I have nieces and nephews and maybe grandkids or in some cases maybe great grandkids. But you know, I feel like, I feel like I'm Uncle John to people, you know, and that makes me feel good. You know, it's like one of my favorite things to do is have the family over for dinner and just sit around and everyone kick back and enjoy themselves.
Definitely,
know?
Definitely.
And me listen to the kids talk. You know, I just love that.
All right. So let's talk Halloween Horror Nights.
Okay, we're going to talk about Halloween Horror Nights at Universal Hollywood, or
we're going to talk Orlando. So we're going to talk about both of them actually.
Okay.
So let's start. Let's take it back to 2018.
Okay.
They introduced the Scare Zone at Universal Studios Orlando.
Yes.
We were, at least I was. I was so jealous because I wanted to go see it so bad. It was the most popular Scare Zone at the event last year.
Mm-hmm.
Did you go and check it out? And if you did, how did you feel seeing everyone react to it?
Well, first of all, it caught me off guard. Because I learned about it in June. Okay, you got to figure, I had a concert in May.
Yeah.
Right? A 30th anniversary on Hollywood Vine, Hollywood and Vine. Sold out 1,000-seat theater. It was so much fun.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm thinking about is putting a concert movie together, right? And all of a sudden, I see this thing for Scare Zone, Killer Klowns from Outer Space, and I'm seeing, like, Orlando, Universal. What? I immediately called the Killer Brothers, we don't know anything about it. This is the first we've heard about it. And they said they heard from some fans that something was going on, but they didn't know what it was. And so they went there first to see it, and they were just, like, so thrilled, right? And all of a sudden on YouTube, tons and tons of videos. Yeah. I made friends with a lot of YouTubers that their bread and butter is going to all the amusement parks in Orlando, which there's, like, it's amusement park land.
Yeah.
Basically, I mean, a giant. When I went there, I didn't realize that there's every conceivable amusement park besides Universal and Disney.
Yeah.
There is. Like there's the Busch Gardens,
yeah.
There's the SeaWorld, and you name a something that someone would be interested in, they made an amusement park out of it.
Oh yeah,
right. So I just had to go. So I figured the best time to go would be in Halloween. So we went. I think it was just like either the week before Halloween, because I don't think it was Halloween proper that we were there. So my wife and I went, and I got to meet up with a YouTuber called Geek Notice.
Okay.
And that's Emily, and she's just really, really sweet. And she gave me a tour. She gave me her personal tour, but I was the guest of Michael Aiello.
Yeah.
Now, Michael Aiello, that was his brainchild.
Yeah.
It's my understanding. He put that together, and I saw, like, the opening night that he was just like a little kid with his camera saying, here it is, it's all together, it's just the way we planned it out. And the colors were, everything was just so fun.
Yeah.
And what amazed me about that move, about that Scare Zone, is that they kind of captured scenes from the movie,
yeah,
and that they play the scare actors play over again. But what was really great is that people would get their drinks or their food, and then they wouldn't leave.
They just sat there.
Yeah, because the Scare Zone is basically you walk by and went, oh, that's amusing. Oh, yeah. Look, there's someone with a scary mask, and you go to the next thing. These people would just hang out and rock out with it, and they were just blaring the music. I thought, I almost said, maybe you should turn it down. It's a little bit too loud, you know. People, because I was having a conversation with, there was fans. I did a fan meet up there.
Yeah.
And we were like yelling at each other. It was so loud.
Yeah.
The music was so loud. They did a projection against the building of scenes from the movie. It was just, you know, the thing, the gag with the shadow puppets?
Yeah.
They did that.
I had heard that on the
side of a building.
They had that, and then they also had the ship taking off, too. I heard there was a projection of that.
Yeah, they did. I never got to see it, but they did some kind of thing with they send up a cloud of mist,
yeah,
and they project it, which is really awesome. Talk about a cool practical effect.
Yeah,
you know?
Definitely.
So that was really neat. And so it was, I felt like a kid.
I mean, they had the ice cream truck there, which was awesome.
I even ordered ice cream. I wanted a lick a stick and a fudgy wudgy bar.
Fudgy wudgies, yes.
But they couldn't get to it.
I know. That was cool. They had actors running around.
Yeah.
And they, you know, and they had, of course, the clowns. Just, you know, they had various props from the guns,
mm-hmm,
to, of course, they had one of the boxing gloves.
Right, right.
That one is, that's hilarious.
I sparred with Shorty.
Yeah. That
was so cool.
What are you gonna do? Knock my block off?
I sparred with him. He gave me an uppercut, and he sat there and laughed.
Yeah, and I just thought,
imagine the nerve.
It was so cool because they had, of course, they even had the clowns walking around with the balloons.
Yes. Oh, and they would. You maybe know this. That sometimes the balloon would would burst, yeah. right? And they would have a funeral for the dog.
Yeah, they'd get all sad and stuff, which I thought was really, really. Like,
and they
really
and they dreamed that up on the spot. Yeah. Probably the who knows but it could have been the script.
And yeah, and I remember hearing Mike Aiello was actually a huge fan of the film. This has been something he's been wanting to bring
yes.
up to the event. And it was I was so jealous that I couldn't go see it last year.
Yeah, it was well, luckily this
luckily,
year
it's gonna be at both. And that's what brings us back to 2019.
Okay.
It's going to be a maze this year at both yes. Orlando and Hollywood.
Now, they call it a maze and a haunted house the same thing, or are they?
So, different? Yeah, it is essentially the same thing. They call it mazes over here and haunted houses over in Orlando.
Okay.
I don't know. I mean, I've always just called them mazes. And so that's just, I've gone to the event since 2011, and mm-hmm. I've always just called them mazes. But I guess over there, that's what they call them.
Right.
So, I mean, I don't know if they translate it different of how they do things over there. Mm-hmm. But going into this year with Halloween Hornets, I mean, it's already stacked lineup. It's like it's a very 80s theme this year. Mm-hmm. And Killer Klowns is of course, a big part of the 80s. Going into this event, is there anything you're really looking forward to? Just kind of seeing some scenes that you like really want to see on the in the maze and stuff to come to life? Of course, I hope they put your music in it.
Well, yeah. You know, it's interesting because I kind of – the Coyote Brothers I kind of have seen when we were making the movie.
Yeah.
Especially the Coyote Brothers have seen kind of beyond how this movie ends. It's like there's so many movies. It's like there's two planets I want to go to in my fantasy sci-fi fantasy.
Yeah.
I want to go to the clown planet.
Oh,
the
yeah.
clown world. And I want to go to the predator planet.
Oh, yeah.
Because I don't know if we could talk about Predator, but I'm a big fan of Predator, and I'm convinced that when you go to the Predator planet, the Predator females are like 6 to 10 times larger than the males. And the reason why they're always traveling around hunting is that they're proving themselves worthy, and when they come back to procreate, they get eaten after they procreate.
Yeah.
And that's their life cycle. So we get to meet the females, and it's probably gravity is much heavier. It's probably like... very hot and humid or something like that. I'm fascinated. Now the clown world, I can't say anything about it.
Yeah.
I can't.
Yeah.
But I had all kinds of ideas. We talked about it over the years, and it is in a, it is documented.
Okay.
And perhaps at some point there will be a manifestation of that. So that's all I could say.
I hope so. I
but it's fascinating.
Because that's one thing I was actually very curious about is, of course, they're like, obviously aliens. They're from outer space.
Right.
But they come in the form of clowns, which a lot of people these days are terrified of.
Right.
I mean, you look at some of the greatest clowns in history. You got, of course, the one from The Terrifier. You got Pennywise.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, the iconic Killer Klowns.
Yeah.
And, you know, the first question that comes to mind when you watch this movie is, okay, where are these clones from?
Right.
And you want to see, okay, how do they live on their planet? What is, you know, what is their day-to-day living and stuff like that? And just, you know, I mean, it'd be an awesome kind of alien, you know, type movie where, like, you know, and how an alien where they have people and they go into outer space and they're exploring mm-hmm. and stuff. And then it'd be cool to see that translate with, a sequel to this where you have people who are like taken off into space and they discover this world.
Well,
that
would be awesome.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, at this date and time, I can't comment on all this. But if I may get very sci-fi nerd on everyone, or a very science fiction-y, actually not science fiction, but like physics kind of thing, we're all aware of gravitational lensing,
oh, yeah.
right, and what have you. So I've always thought, so fascinating, you see the Killer Klown spaceship, that inside it's like infinitely large.
It's huge.
Right, inside. But outside it doesn't appear large.
It's just a surface.
And I would always think if in real life, if some kind of quote-unquote intelligent life form landed a craft and it land and you would get close to it, there would be some kind of gravitational lensing because from far away, oh, it looks like it's as big as a normal circus tent. And as you get closer, all of a sudden that lensing expands it and it's like so massively big. But because you were at a certain distance away, it seemed like a normal size, you know. And there's got to be all kinds of crazy things that happens when you go in, you know, in a trans-dimensional ship, you know. There's all kinds of crazy things that would happen to you, you know, that would keep your molecules from being blown apart, you know. Yeah. So they've had to have figured out all those problems, all those issues to be able to travel and whatever, bend space to move through it and what have you. But it's just very fascinating. So since I was a little kid, I've always loved science fiction. I used to watch Lost in Space. I lived for that show. As a matter of fact, one of my falling in love with John Williams' music is I used to have a little Philips reel-to-reel tape recorder. It had a reel that big on it. And it can record a whole, I think, 10 minutes at 1 3/4 inches per second, you know, moving. Basically, I think it moved the speed of a cassette deck, but the reel was this big. And so I would record as much of the music as I could and then play it back next to the piano and try to pick out notes and things like that. Because there was something in that was very, in his music, that was very evocative to me, you know. And some of, by the way, just a quick note, my favorite John Williams score is The Reavers and The Cowboys. That has nothing to do with fantasy or Star Wars or anything. Those are like incredibly crafted scores that I still listen to today. So,
yeah. Speaking of scores, going back to Killer Klowns here. Mm-hmm. Typically, space movies, John Williams, mm-hmm. Hans Zimmer. These are the people you're thinking about mm-hmm. when it comes to really taking you to another space. And they're using orchestras. What really made you decide to use synthesizers in the original score?
Well, it was a very conscientious decision. Okay, the Keeler brothers were very explicit. They're big fans of classic horror and sci-fi and fantasy films like Mighty Joe Young, King Kong, the classic ones, the Definitely. First ones. Yeah, and the Seventh Voyage of Sinbad. All of those had full-blown legit orchestras. However, for Killer Klowns, they wanted a very special color. So it came down to this very high concept. So you're going to record a classic. You're going to compose a classic score. It's going to be performed on synthesizers to help accentuate the colors that we have here, the bizarre world.
Definitely. I think that was a great choice because mm-hmm. I think it adds to the absurdity of the film mm-hmm. and does make it more colorful. Because obviously, you most scores you hear in an orchestra, mm-hmm. good to go. But a synthesizer really takes it, like, caught me off guard, at least when I watched the film for the first mm-hmm. time. And I was like, and as a musician, I was like, okay, this is a really cool choice. Mm-hmm. And really changes the way that you see the movie. Mm-hmm. And so I applaud you on that. And
oh, thanks. Brothers on that. It was a lot of fun. It was a lot of fun doing that because there was a lot of interesting choices. And I still have that gear. It's at a friend of mine's studio.
Oh, cool.
I don't use it as much. I actually... Purists are going to be really upset with me, but I actually use virtual synthesizers.
Definitely.
Because they're just easier to manage.
Yeah, definitely way easier. And obviously with the 30th, you had the live orchestra. Yes. Is there any, obviously you had mentioned that there's plans for maybe the film coming out with it, of the live orchestra. Is there a plan to take it back on tour eventually?
Mm-hmm. Well, step one is that we did make a concert movie that we're finishing up.
Definitely.
And it looks really nice, and it sounds really nice. It's a lot of fun. I think we captured... What's interesting is that you can capture the energy of the audience's reaction.
Oh, that's really cool.
And it has a different energy when you hear live musicians playing with it, especially the Dickies song, because the Dickies were at the concert and they played obviously they played at the beginning and at the very end. And can I tell you an interesting Dickies story?
Yes.
Go for it. Okay. Love stories.
So I got about days before the concert, when we were going to have the first rehearsal, Leonard, the leader of the band, was concerned that had certain concerns, and I go, Leonard, all you gotta do is play the song like you usually do. We're following you. That's it. That's all. Yeah, that's it. You don't have to change a thing, you know. You just sit there and play. And the first, I have a recording of the rehearsal when we ran through it the very first time, and it just kicked ass. Because the band, the orchestra, who were like the top call people in the business. I mean, the you can see pick out certain individuals from that orchestra. Trumpet player played on one of the Star Wars, the recent one. I think he played on with Michael Giacchino. He played on Rogue One, and the other one of the John Williams scores. The cellist, both or two of the cellists. Every one of them has played in. You know, with either Hans Zimmer, with Michael Giacchino, with John Williams, Henry Gregson Williams, all the big names. Yeah, and they were. What was so great is that they were so on board with doing this. You know, they were just like, "Oh, this is gonna be a lot of fun." So when the Dickies played the song and the band came in with them, it was just wild because I had two drummers. I had the drummer from the Dickies, and I had Bob Brinker, who's a famous studio drummer. They were just like boom, boom, playing in sync. It was just really there's just a lot of energy. The other guitar and bass player were basically playing the similar parts, and so you had like this double, you had this like wall of sound, basically.
Yeah, and I would have loved to just sit there and hear that wall of sound. There's nothing more fun than just listening to a live orchestra.
Yeah,
especially when you're going. With a band too, like the Dickies playing, and just sitting there. I can only imagine standing in front of them and being able to, you know, conduct them as they're doing this.
Leonard was telling me, no, at one point we have to come out. How are we going to do that? Well, we just like start playing softer and then we come out. That's it. It's going to be that easy. Besides, it's not going to matter, Leonard. Everyone's going to be screaming.
Yeah, definitely.
Which is what happened. My wife was there with and my daughters and a bunch of other friends who said some people just stood up to the whole concert. You know,
I can only imagine.
It was a lot of fun. So when you see the movie with hearing the audience reactions, and some people had never seen it with an audience or seen it on a big screen.
Oh, wow.
And we not only had one screen, we had two screens. We had two smaller screens at the side. So no matter where you were, you got to see the experience of the movie.
Also in 2019, we had the pleasure for us Stranger Things fans of getting a little bit of your music. And was that the first episode?
Right.
How did that come about?
Well, I think, you know, the Duffer Brothers have a big affection for a lot of genre of music, and I think Killer Klowns is one of them.
Yeah.
So I got a call months before, let me see, May, was it? No, May, June, July, I think it was in May. I had a call, and they said, we're doing this episode, we need this music. I got a call from the music supervisor. And she said that we need this music, and I got it. It was on the phone. I saw it. I will get to this today. And 30 seconds later, I get a phone call.
So, oh, wow.
No, we have to do it now. I go, okay, let me go home. So there's like things that they needed. They needed certain documentation, certain types of tracks, a certain way. So we got that all. And I go, and that's fantastic. I'm honored. Just curious, what is it for? They said it was, all I knew it was Netflix and Stranger Things.
Yeah.
And they says, it's for the premiere episode. I go, oh, cool. So yeah, really we got awesome. Together. I had not seen it. And it showed up in the first 10 minutes or so of the first episode.
Yeah.
And here's what's amusing to me is everyone taking with their cell phone and Instagramming the scene and saying, yep, that's definitely Killer Klowns. Oh, that's definitely Killer Klowns. And that's, you know, that's what, it was so funny to see that. And I actually saw it the first, you know, after midnight. I didn't think about it. I was with my family and they said, hey, Dad, isn't your thing on tonight? I go, what thing? Stranger Things. I go, oh, yeah, let's watch it. And I go, have you ever seen Stranger Things? And they go, no, never saw it. And so we watched it, and they picked it up before me. When they're, Dad, there's your thing, you know. So, and then afterwards, after we saw that premiere episode, is in true form, they said, well, we have to go to season one, and start. And so they binged watched everything until. Like 8 a.m.
Oh wow, that's a long night.
Yeah, so they watched all of them and they got up to speed. You know, so I thought that was kind of cool. So Stranger Things has like 5 more people, 10 more people as fans. Like they don't need.
They don't need more. They just got more.
Billions, yeah. So that was it. Was a lot of fun. When I got the call, it was very, very. It was a big thrill.
I imagine.
All right. So I'm going to go get over to some fan questions that we actually had. We asked a bunch of fans on on Instagram and Twitter to tell us.
No, these are fans of yours.
Fans of mine, yes.
That is cool.
Also some fans of yours.
Oh,
big. You got a lot of fans. That music is beautiful. This one actually, one of my biggest fans, of course, is my girlfriend.
Ah.
Yes.
What's your name?
Her name is Tammy.
Hi, Tammy.
Yes. So John Massari says hi, Tammy. Of course, she'll be watching me edit this tonight. So.
And she'll be watching you edit like this.
Yep. She's like,
when are you going to be finished?
That's fine. But she has a ton of questions for you. She's actually, I showed her the movie when we first started dating. I came over to her house and brought like three horror movies, two of which she'd never seen. One of them was Killer Klowns.
But three horror movies, not Flowers.
Not Flowers. Okay. Yeah. The three horror movies. So we watched.
This is the man for me. He brought me these movies where people get their heads cut off and blood comes spurting out of their open, exposed neck.
You know, it was
love him.
It was a fun night because it was Killer Klowns, The Lost Boys, and The Shining.
Other women are getting candy and flowers and, you know, trips to Hawaii, and she got horror, and she appreciates it.
She loved it.
That's the best part. Yes. That she appreciates it.
Yeah, because I told her, I was like, Killer Klowns is a must watch, especially because this was before we knew it was coming to the event, but we kind of like, we were on the prediction kind of boat where we were like, okay, I think it's coming to the event this year.
Right.
So I was like, so you just got to watch it just in case it does come to the event. That way,
well, Tammy could have came here if she wanted.
Oh, I will let her know. She actually was like, really like looking forward. She was cheering me on, like, I can't wait to watch this podcast and stuff. So Tammy, you know, John Massari, he sent you an invite. So she wants to know a little bit about your composing. So okay. Can you give us a little bit more of an insight of how you compose, as far as like methods you use or how things come to you?
Well, that's in a variety of ways. I can tell you how I did it with Killer Klowns from Outer Space.
Okay.
I looked at the movie and, I don't want to get too technical, but I would look at the movie all the way through and I would walk away from it and think about the movie, like go outside, take a walk, not play at the piano yet. Just like let the movie live in my mind.
Yeah.
Right? And we're not talking about days.
Yeah.
We're talking like maybe an hour or two.
Just kind of let it sit there.
Yeah. And then I go, I had this really cool thing on my VHS. I had a scroll, a thing where I could scrub.
Okay.
So I would like put the thing, so I watch the whole movie fast. And I made several copies because VHS sometimes gets eaten up.
Yeah.
Right. So I would watch the whole movie fast. Just like not take my eyes off it. Just like just concentrate on the movie and then watch it backwards. And do like three or four times. And it's interesting, once you see, when you compress the time of the movie, and you're not hearing the dialogue, obviously, it's going like whatever, right? So, but you're seeing all the events.
Yeah.
And the events of the movie, of the story, starts getting ingrained in your head.
Yeah.
Where now you have the cadence of the movie. Because to sit there and watch an hour and a half movie three or four times can be kind of time consuming. But I found out, now I learned this from a composer named Jerry Fielding, who did a lot of Clint Eastwood movies. He did, if you're a fan of Star Trek, he did the Trouble with Tribbles episode.
Okay.
So I worked as an apprentice with him, and that's how he would, when he got a movie and, you know, VHS and we had 3/4-inch video or VHS. It was a thing. Oh, that's what we had to look up. Before that, people used to have actually like a little projector next to them called a moviola. It's the noisiest, most obnoxious thing in the world. You'd have to change the reels every 10 minutes or 20 minutes.
Okay.
It was, thank God I missed that. And no one had a romance for seeing that come back, having that, because you had to rent it.
Yeah.
You know, and you almost couldn't buy the damn thing. You always had to rent it from a company. But in any event, so I would like zip it by over and over again. I got a cadence for it. And then, you know, by this time I had the movie as my movie. So I would pick, I look at, I have in my mind, I have each scene.
Okay.
That music. We've already talked about, between me and the Kyoto Brothers, what scenes was going to have music and where it was going to come out, what was important. Maybe they had made notes. I need you to take this really seriously. This has to be like seriously dramatic. I go, this, and this could be a little bit playful and light, but it has to get serious. It's like the puppet shows. It almost sounds like a, you know, Warner Brothers cartoon
type of
approach, right? And so I have it all in my head visually. And then I get at the piano and I just start plucking away, you know, just start, you know, thinking of what I want to do. And then I'll listen to music. I listen to, from the classical repertory, I listen to Prokofiev and Shostakovich. Prokofiev did a ballet, and there was a suite from the ballet called the Scythian Suite. And I listened to that a number of times, and I liked the way that felt, the colors and all that. And with Shostakovich, it was his Symphony Number 8.
Okay.
It had all the driving stuff in it, you know, and I just kind of like let that sit in my head. You know, and so I come up with a sheet full of like themes, motifs, like little notes, chord sequences. Mm-hmm. You know, because sometimes you can have like a chord sequence. It's not necessarily a melody, but it's the chords make a mood that could like bridge you to another scene and things like that. So I came up with all that. I spent probably 2 or 3 days doing that. Then I went to my synthesizer. And I would play those sounds, and I would start creating new sounds that I wanted to, that I thought would sound weird. Oh, this is good for the little popcorn, the little tweaky sound, and this is like a big dong, like a weird gong sound. You hear it when they go into that reactor room. There's like a bong, right? I created that from scratch.
Okay.
So I got all my colors and my sounds. So I did that. And then I meticulously went to every scene and started saying, okay, how do I, from this like menu of like themes and stuff, that theme would be perfect here, but play down 2 octaves or something like that. So that's basically how I work. I hope that makes sense.
No, definitely.
I didn't, you know, and, you know, I if I could say this, I don't think anyone should be intimidated by the classical repertory, because not even I am familiar with everything. It's monstrously voluminous. You know, even from the Renaissance, from the medieval to the Renaissance to the early classic period, classic, post-romantic, there's so much to learn. But if you find something that appeals to you, and you can learn something from it, you know. And that's helped me in all styles of music. So
this is another one from Tammy here, his girlfriend. What led you to become a film composer? Was it like something you wanted to do at a young age, or was it something that you grew into?
Tammy asks really great questions. Well, music gave me an experience. When I was a little kid, when I was a tiny kid, my parents had what we used to call a hi-fi system. It was basically a furniture cabinet with speakers in it and a turntable and a radio tuner. And they used to play all kinds of music, and I was just fascinated with it. And it, even at 2 and 3 years old, I would always turn it on, just listen to music, and just change channels. And later on, I started, I got my own little radio. I would just constantly listen to music. I was constantly switching channels, listening to all sorts of music. And then I would make musical instruments. I wanted to play guitar. Never did. I learned piano later, but I used to make instruments with like a ruler and rubber bands, right? So when I was 6 years old, my mom got a piano, and I really didn't pay that much attention to it because it was like hers. But I went to a triple feature with my friends. We used to be in Little League Baseball and things like that. It was like 6 or 7. And it was The Time Machine, Mysterious Island, and Journey to the Center of the Earth. It's basically where you could send your kids and be babysitted for 50 cents. You know, we'd watch this triple feature. And I was completely swept off my feet. I just thought that they were the most awesome things in the world. And so it's that music that kind of like made me start tinkering. And I thought to myself, about 5 years later, I was like 9 or 10. I said, I want to write music for movies and TV, you know. And no, my parents didn't know what the heck that was.
Definitely. So you do have a wide repertoire beyond Killer Klowns from Outer Space. Mm-hmm. You've worked in film, obviously. You've worked in TV. Mm-hmm. You've even done some video games. Mm-hmm. Which one did you enjoy most? Do you enjoy film more, TV, or video game composing?
Well, I just enjoy making music.
Yeah.
You know, you know, it doesn't matter what the end thing is. Like I say, well, I have to do movies instead of television. They're all great. It's all great musical experience. I don't have one preference over the other.
Okay, perfect. So again, Tammy, like I said, one of your biggest fans. She's asking a lot of good questions here. This is gonna be a two-parter right here. So, what is your view on the value of music today, and what would you do if you weren't? What would you think you would have been doing today if you didn't go into the world of composing?
Okay, that's a two-fold question. What was the first part of the question?
The first part was, what's your view on music today? The value of it.
Oh, well, music is always going to be something that people cherish, of all kinds of music.
Yeah,
I think that's one of the best things that humankind has created. Mm-hmm. Really, it's so wonderful. Music gives everyone a great experience. It can put you in a mood. We have to leave. Run!
All right.
That was the coffee. But you mean, what's my opinion in film music today?
Either film or just standard music general.
I just love all the variety. Everyone's manifestation is I know it came out a few years ago, but Atticus Ross did The Book of Eli. And it's just, first of all, the movie, it hits on all cylinders. It's firing on all cylinders. And the music is so emotional.
Yeah.
I forgot his last name. I think it's Johansson. He did Arrival, the score to Arrival.
Yeah, that's the one with, what's her name? Amy Adams, right?
Yeah. And it's such a gorgeous score and such a powerful movie, you know. So there's wonderful music being written.
Yeah.
Which is really encouraging. There's stuff that just fascinates me. Things I hear that fascinates me. Austin Wintory did a video game. It had an aquatic underwater theme, and it's just like such gorgeous creative music. You could just tell that not to get too music geeky, but it was very influenced by the impressionist era, French impressionist era of music, I feel that it was. And there's a lot of great music being created. It's just wonderful.
And in a what-if world, what would you think you'd be doing if you weren't composing?
I'd be into mineral exploration. I'd be traveling the world like Indiana Jones.
Nice. You'd be archaeologist.
There you go.
Because I actually had mining claims in the desert north of here that I discovered myself.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I read an article by someone that worked for the government, who they were looking for tungsten ore. And this is like one sentence in his report. And I had to read about this in the library, by the way. Anyways, it said, I had never seen so much surface gold in my life. So I went out there, and for crying out loud, it was there. And no one had claimed it. So I claimed it, and then a Canadian mining company leased it for me for about 6 or 7 years.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. So, but I love being in the outdoors where it's like there's no one around for like hundreds of miles.
Awesome. And then the last fan question we have here actually comes from The Brick Monster on Instagram.
Brick Monster.
He wants to know.
The Brig Monster.
Brick.
Brick Monster. That's a badass name.
Yeah.
Brick Monster.
He wants to know, since, you know, I think, so prior to Killer Klowns being into the event, have you been to Halloween Horror Nights other than?
No.
No?
No. I mean, I didn't really. Last time I went to a fan convention was a very long time ago.
Yeah.
And they were nowhere near as cool as they are today.
Okay.
And I got invited by the Killer Brothers to go to the 25th anniversary.
Okay.
Of Killer Klowns. And that's where I met all the fans. I met people who knew more about the movie than I did.
Yeah.
And that were like, that were actually moved by what I did. And, yeah. And I didn't really have a connection until then. So it kind of like, it's really grown very quickly in the past 5 years.
Definitely. So you mentioned you went to HHN last year. So what did you go through a lot of the houses and stuff? And
yeah, I got a tour from Emily.
Okay.
of uh, of Geek Notice. Okay. That's her YouTube channel that I'm plugging.
I'll put it in the link below so she can, you can find her out.
And she gave me, she knows it backwards and forwards. She knows the place. She knows every nook and cranny of the Orlando, and the, especially the Halloween Horror Nights.
Yeah.
And that was a lot of fun. Okay. So it was the first time I had ever been there.
Did you have a favorite HHN maze?
Gosh, it was. It's to me, it's like all one big experience. I got to say, I did like Poltergeist.
Okay.
Yeah, that was awesome. Poltergeist
was good. Anyone you want to plug in, shout out?
Anyone?
Any people that in your community that you love?
Well, yeah, well, there's... I would like to give a plug to the Seishura Youth Orchestra. I'm on the board of it and of the Seishura Youth Orchestra, and I really am very proud to help bring music programs to schools that don't have the budget for a music program.
That's incredible.
Yeah. So we start off with one school here in, we're in Glendale, which is, if no one knows where Glendale is, if you know where the Hollywood sign is in Hollywood, on the other side of the hill is this beautiful little city called Glendale. And that's where I live. It's called, they call it the Jewel City. Anyways, there's a school here in Glendale and that we had originally, and then we have a second school that we offer a program. And we not only offer education, we also give them, they can use the instruments, they can choose an instrument, and they don't have to buy an instrument, in other words.
That is incredible.
And they get food.
Awesome.
We get, like, so it's an after school, so twice a week they get an after school meal, not just a snack, and they get awesome instruction, and they have really great teachers that are teaching.
That is
the kind of teacher I wish I had.
Sounds incredible. Yeah. You do that. Yeah, we are very just happy to be here in your presence. And
well, I'm very happy that you guys came over, and I'm glad you brought this big wad of chewing gum.
Oh yeah, when I saw Fats at the convention, it was a must. I had to buy it. John, thank you so much for taking the time to get this interview. We are very excited. Thank you for tuning in to the Mindless Horror Podcast for Summer of Guests. We're so happy for this interview. And this gave us a whole behind-the-scenes look of how the movie was made, just talking about Halloween Horror Nights, the concert, and stuff like that. So we cannot wait, for the concert to come out on DVD. We're very much looking forward to that one.
Yeah, that's going to be awesome.
Before we go, though.
Yes.
And I know you can't talk a lot about it.
They're going to ask me the question.
The question. What can you tell us about a potential sequel for Killer Klowns?
Okay, here it is. Should I read the official statement given to me?
If you want to read the official statement, that way it's more. It's a.
I state your name. No. Okay, so here's what I can tell you. There is always going to be something incredible and wonderful happening with the Killer Klowns. Take two. Here's my response to that very well framed question. You can always expect some wonderful creative surprise coming from the Killer Klowns from Outer Space brand. That's all I can tell you.
Okay, that gives me hopes.
Always
right
something
there.
Good gonna be happening.
That gives me hopes right there. So John, again, thank you very much
for
this.
You got it, man.
Appreciate it. And
you guys are awesome.
We'll see you guys in the next episode.